And in Leviticus 21, and we're moving on from the first of 12 blemishes that disqualify you from being a priest and from functioning as a priest. For whatsoever man he be that hath a blemish, he shall not approach. A blind man, or a lame man, or he that hath a flat nose, or anything superfluous. Let's talk about lameness. Obviously, that refers to your walk. Your walk. And there are a lot of people, even in the message of Christ and Him crucified, that can talk the talk. I mean, there are a lot. I mean, there's not a lot of people in the population or in Christianity that know the message, but among those that do, there are a lot that can talk the talk. And so they feel that that is, you know, where it's at. But they do not walk the walk. And saying the right truths, we can do that. You know, saying things in right order, we can do that. But if we fail to live it, then it's not Christ as life. I mean, I wonder why we ended up with that name for the big, broad name to cover everything. I know how we did, because it's not Christ as message. It is Christ as life. And so, if we have lameness, you can't be a priest. You can be a priest in title. You can sit at the table and eat the bread. You can eat and eat and eat. And you can talk about it and talk about it and talk about it. But if you don't, if you have lameness, then you can't function as a priest, not in the eyes of the Lord. And so if the message becomes everything instead of living it, then our emphasis becomes on the mouth, and it becomes on how things are said rather than how we live. And that's, I think that's a good little phrase. The emphasis becomes on how things are said. All of a sudden, there becomes a paranoia. I'm afraid to speak for fear that I will say something wrong. I won't say it right. Anybody ever had that fear around here? I'm afraid to speak for fear that I won't say it right. Have you had that fear with me? I hope not, because I don't really care how you say it. You don't have to say it like me or like anybody that you're familiar with. You honestly, if you just love the Lord, I figure you'll end up knowing the Lord and being conformed to His image. I mean, I think if you love the Lord, then you'll want Him to be manifested through you, not just grab hold of a message. Because, you know, I know people who love the message. They do. They love it. I mean, they are infatuated. Really. I mean, I've seen people that infatuated. I've had people come up to me after I've preached and just go, oh, my God. I mean, it was like they just fell in love. Not with me, but, you know. But with what was shared. And it's just like, oh, I've never heard anything in my life. That just rings so true. Well, we've all said that. We've said, I've never heard anything like, and it rings so true in my spirit. But you don't go, oh, and I'm just in love with words put in a certain order. Because basically that's all it is. For the most part, there's not a whole lot of new words presented in the preaching of Christ and Him crucified. Maybe some emphasized more than others, like crucified or whatever, you know. But I mean, it's not a new word, you know. I mean, I make up words, so sometimes when I'm preaching, you'll hear new words, but they don't mean anything. I'm making them up. But you know, it's just this whole thing of having to have, you know, we have to all say it. See, it's not, the Bible talks about we all say the same things, but it's not what it doesn't mean is that we all say exactly the same words and nobody dare say anything out of the understanding of me, the leader, or whatever. Because if you do say something that's not up to my understanding, then you will be looked down on. I mean, I know people that have been in this message for, you know, 20 years more than me. Maybe not 20. Probably not 20. But a lot more. And I figure, I mean, you know, I've been preaching Christ and Him crucified for 35 years at this point, 35 years. And so, you know, we've got Amber that's just come in, or Matt, or Josiah, or somebody, you know. And so now you have to say everything on my level, like now you're only a couple of years at, you know, maybe in this at all, maybe not even that long, but you have to say everything according to what I say with my level of understanding, as if 35 years magically forms in you. No. There you have it. You know? But what that means to me is, I mean, we've all sat around and shared here and in Washington, we've shared, and they've actually shared some things that wasn't exactly right before. And I'm sure they remember my response when they said it, and I went, "You're so wrong!" No, I don't do that. God taught me, and it took 35 years to even get my attention almost, you know. So, you know, you're fine. You're not going to see everything perfect every time. God will clarify things. God will make it sharper. Just keep walking. If the point is a message, then we're going to crucify everybody who doesn't say everything just like we like it. And it cannot be that way. Now, we're not responsible for other places. We can't make any changes in any other place. But we can here make sure that we love everybody and that they don't have to see everything just like we see it, and they don't have to be on our level to be loved and accepted. And I tell you what, man, you've heard me say this for years now. But I mean, somebody that stands up in church and all they know is Jesus saves, if it's real in their heart, that blesses me. It blesses me. It is, if it's real and alive in them, I want to hear it. I don't care, you know, and go, whoa, you know, instead of going, "Well, my God, there's a lot more to this than Jesus saves." Well, yeah, there is, but, you know, I remember when Jesus saves lit my fire. It was, you know, it was incredible. And it's still incredible. And I'm glad that people are knowing the Lord on any level. And I want to encourage them, you know. You don't want to discourage people. So I was thinking about this scripture over here in the Gospel of John, chapter 1. Turn there, John chapter 1, in verse 35. It says, Gospel of John, chapter 1, verse 35. "Again, the next day, John stood and two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, he said, 'Behold the Lamb of God.' And the two disciples heard him speak, and they followed Jesus." Okay. If these disciples, now notice, when verse 35 starts out, and 36, we only read 35, 36, and 37. When it starts out, John has two disciples. When it ends, just two verses later, he's minus two disciples. Do you see that? He had two disciples, and then He pointed out Jesus, and they walked and they followed Jesus. Okay. Now, if John had not been a very good man of God, if his emphasis was only the people that are with me are really the right people, the people of God. Only those who adhere to my teachings and follow me, then his words would have been something like this, and his teaching. Behold, the Lamb of God. Just look at him. He would have found Jesus sitting somewhere and said, now let's go over there and just look at him for a while. And so John would walk over and his two disciples and Jesus sitting there and they'd have gone. You know, just focusing, looking at Jesus. Yeah. And then after a while, they'd pull off. Okay, let's go. They'd walk off. And we all saw Jesus. We all looked at Jesus. We all had our eyes on Jesus. Wasn't that good? Yeah, what'd you get from it, young disciple? Well, I saw Jesus. I saw him with his big blue eyes, and he was so compassionate and sweet, and I'm telling you, I just, you know, well, what did you get? Oh, I saw depth behind that face. I'm telling you, I saw that, you know, and you just, all this, you know. And so you sit around and you talk about it. What'd you see? What'd you see? Well, what did you see? Well, it's all Jesus. That's good. But notice John saw Jesus as he walked. That's what it says right here. As he walked and said, behold the Lamb of God. It's a walk. The Lamb, let me say it like this. There's a Lamb walk. Amen? There's a walk to this. Not just a talk. There's a walk. And so John waited for the Lamb to come by walking, not sitting over somewhere that they all walk over and they all just look at him, they examine him, and they, you know, I mean, you know, like I said, it can be like a physician or a biologist dissecting Jesus, you know, Jesus sitting there and you pull out your scalpel and you start cut his nose off and go, now look at that. I want to get to know Jesus better and closer, you know. And look, there's some little wrinkles and stuff right there on his nose I never noticed before. And then you pin that up on your Jesus bulletin board that you're trying to get to know him. And, you know, somebody else starts cutting away, hacking away, trying to get to know Jesus. It's not all the realities of what he did or it is to know his heart. And when I say know his heart, I never mean know his heart in a situation. I mean, you got to know his heart. You got to know the way that he is. If you know his heart, if you know the way he is, then different situations don't throw you. But if you're thinking wrong, then you're going to go, okay, I got to know Jesus' heart in this situation. No, he's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Get to know him, his heart. When I say get to know him, I mean his heart, his way. And then when you do, the things come easier. So John, wise man that he was, because John, from the very beginning, said, I'm not him. I'm not it. People came to John. Big shots came to John and said, who are you? Who are you? And of course, we all, you know, we're all working on our reputation. Jesus made himself of no reputation, but we're all working on our reputation. Oh, I want to tell you who I am. You know, I remember one time for something, Doug asked me for a, well, there's a bunch of us. He asked for a sort of a bio of yourself. And he asked several. And so everybody got theirs in. And Doug's calling me week in, Randy, everybody's got their bio in. We got to have it before we go to this conference. They want to have it. I said, what do you want me to say? I'm a great man of God? I'm, you know, what? I mean, come on. What? I mean, think about it. What? Well, okay, you know. you know, all of the things that the people want to hear when they read it, I don't think is anything. That's not where it's at. I mean, I could put, I love Jesus for 30, you know, some odd years, but they'd go, well, big deal. This guy, he's, you know what I mean? He raised up and he's been on the mission field. He's gone around the world. And you just love Jesus for that long? Is that it? You know, so finally, Doug found something. I forget what he did, but he came up with something and he sent it in. And so sure enough, man, when we got there, you know, I got to read this really neat thing. He said, okay, here, I just did this. Is this okay? And I read it and I said, gosh, I'm a really cool person. You know? John was a good man. When you ask him about himself, he didn't say, I'm a good man. Isn't that cool? He was a good man because he didn't point to himself. The fact that, I mean, it was clear where he was coming from. When you wanted to talk about him, you were going to end up talking about Jesus. Isn't that precious? If you want to talk, you know, it's kind of like John goes, well, if you want to talk about me, you're going to have to talk about the one. Because I've only got a voice. I am only a voice to speak of this one. He's the one. I'm not the one. Who are you? I? Not worthy. There is one who is before me. See, those are the kind of words that he uses, and he's not trying to be humble. Here's the key. If you recognize the cross, and you recognize, I am not worthy, so I, okay, let's start with over here in the old creation. Maybe I should take this off. If we talk about the old creation, you know, you're just a square, man. Over here, I am. Well, in the old creation, in Adam, I am not worthy. I am less than the least. I am in myself nothing. But then you come over here to the cross and you say, I am. Okay. Oh, you want to talk about, you didn't want to talk about me from over in this perspective. If we do talk from over here in the old creation, me before union with Christ, the true vine, then I am not worthy. It's not that I'm humble. I know that this is slated for death. This old creation is rejected of God. So it's foolish for me to try to better myself. Can I get an amen? It's just clear when you see it like that. So then you say, okay, but you want to talk about the I am of me at the cross. Okay, well, I am crucified. Okay? I'm crucified then, okay? Well, okay, you want to talk about me in the new creation, then you can't say I am anymore. You say he is the I am. He is Alpha and Omega. He is beginning and end. He is the length and the breadth and the height and the depth. He is the fullness that filleth all and in all. We have to talk about Jesus. Now, if you're going to talk about me now in resurrection, people say, I'm tired of talking about death. Let's talk about resurrection. Okay, well, we won't talk about you ever again. I mean, there has to be some reality to this. There has to be a walk related to this. Your walk will never line up if it's just a message. You know what? You'll talk about resurrection, but you'll talk about you. You'll talk about, well, I'm really something now, and I've got self-esteem. I thought self was crucified. Well, then I got esteem. Who are you applying it to? Self's crucified. Well, then I got Jesus. Ah, there. We have Jesus. Jesus is our everything. In Christ, in union with Christ, He is all and in all. He is the one that pleases the Father, and we are his members that express him. You see, it's not humility. It's reality. Reality brings, if you want to call it humility, you know. I remember sharing once, and, you know, I was sharing, and I said, you know, folks, we had a couple of thousand people there, and I was sharing, and I said, it was my second time, and I was going to be sharing a couple more times, and it was like on the second day or something, and I said, don't think I'm anything or any of these other speakers or anything. We're nothing. It's not about us. It's about Christ. And I had a couple of people come up afterwards and go, oh, you shouldn't be so humble, brother. God has blessed you to show you Jesus, and you're just a great man of God, and we recognize you as such. And I said, are you listening to what I'm preaching? I mean, you could not possibly be getting what I'm saying. I am dead. I'm not humble. I'm dead. And I recognize that. And it's good that I'm dead. Because if I wasn't and you came to me with that, before too long I'd be running this place and you'd all be bound down to me. You better thank the Lord for the cross. You know. So there is this thing where and what I started this with was I said, John was a good man, but he didn't say he was a good man. He was a good man in that he pointed to Jesus. He was a good man in that he would not lift himself up. He only lifted Jesus up. And when you talk to John about him, he could not talk about himself except in relationship to the one. To the resurrection, to Christ himself. And so, they're his disciples. They were his disciples. God added them to John, did they not? God added those disciples to John. John added them to Jesus. What I found out in all these years of preaching and being a minister is that people either love you or hate you. I mean, they're just like, just love you and think you're just the best thing since buttered bread, or they hate you and want you dead. Buttered bread or dead. It's my incredible poetic skills breaking forth. And no, it never mind. And so, shall we go on? So there is this reality that people, it's like they can't hear what you're saying. When I say they can't hear what you're saying, let me say it like this. They can't grasp the walk that is involved. They're too busy loving the message. Ezekiel chapter 33. Scripture the Lord shared with me within just 1 year of coming to a revelation of Christ. Ezekiel 33 and verse 31 to the end. And they come unto thee as the people come, and they sit before thee as if they were my people, and they hear thy words, but they will not do them. For with their mouth they show much love, but their heart goeth after their covetousness. And lo, Thou art unto them as a very lovely song of one that hath a pleasant voice and can play well on an instrument. For they hear thy words, but they do them not. And when this cometh to pass, lo, it will come. Then shall they know that a prophet hath been among them. It is as if you're singing a beautiful song, and they love the note order. They love the particular chords that you play for them. They love the style. They love the voice. They love what it brings, and the hope or the reality or the doors that are open or the veils that are rent or whatever. But they are not going to walk it. They're too much in love with the song of it. It's beautiful to them. Can anybody here understand that? I can understand that. I mean, I can fully understand that. I can understand that this message is a beautiful song. It is a gorgeous song. It was put into a song called the Song of Songs. Somebody wrote the song and called it the Song of All Songs. It is. And it's so pleasant to hear. I mean, especially when somebody's just, you know, the old saying, picking it up and laying it down. You know what I'm talking about? They are unfolding. You know, it's like taking verses that you've known all your life and you just all of a sudden go, oh my God, that's what it's saying, my Lord. You know, and you're just going, this is incredible, you know. But wait. You know, it's like being in love with love. You know, I mean, there are people that fall in love with love, you know. I mean, I want to be in love. You know, they're not thinking of a guy. They're thinking of the feelings. Hello? Oh, I just want to be in love, because when I'm in love, I swoon, and, you know. I don't know that I'm the best for describing what being in love is like. It's not that I'm in love, it's that I'm an orphan that doesn't fully comprehend all feelings and stuff. But I know that, I mean, I know that there's, it's like, oh, you know, I just think about this person and I love that, because my mind, before I was in love, I just thought of, you know, laundry. I mean, that does make it better, doesn't it? Come on. You know, I mean, before I thought of laundry, and now I think of you. What am I, you know, super laundry? What am I? Laundry on steroids? Is that what I am to you? But, you know, I mean, it's like, it's just this, it is not really being in love with the person that is so much in the forefront. It is just the joy of feeling like you're in love. Well, let's talk about God's love. For God so loved the world that he crucified his son. By this perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for the brethren, and we ought to do the same. I mean, in true love, there's a walk. And the walk is the Lamb. You see the Lamb walking, and you don't go, I saw that. I want to preach a new sermon. I got a new sermon. I saw the Lamb walking. I want to talk about it. You know, one of the things some of you may remember, a man from years back, his name was Arthur Blessed. How many of you remember him? He's the guy that carried this cross all over the world. He pulled this cross, You know, and, you know, Jesus said, take up the cross and everything. Now, I think he meant more than, you know, make a piece of wood and whatever. But I, you know, I loved Arthur Bless, and I thought he was a great man. And, you know, there is the, you know, I remember him talking on a talk show once, and they said, you know, you're a hard man to get on TV to talk, you know, to talk about what you do, but you've led, you know, thousands of people to the Lord. You've talked to probably a million people about Jesus, you know. And he said, I just, you know, I just want you to tell us about witnessing. And he said, well, I'm just really uncomfortable here. And they said, don't say that, you know, that makes our show look bad. And he said, no. He said, I'm just uncomfortable. He said, because I'd rather be doing it than sitting here talking about it. You know, that always stuck with me because I thought how much we all talk about it. Everything, you know. I mean, we're doing it right now. I'm doing it. That's why it's so important to me, that I live this and that I leave here walking, following the Lamb, walking. Because to follow the Lamb really means to walk, doesn't it? It means to walk the way he walks, to go the way he goes. And to me, that's that lamb that's walking, if you could put it like this, the one that is that I'm following. Now I know we're in him and one with him, but I'm using the metaphor of walking. That one that I'm following, the beauty of him makes me not so aware of where I'm going, but who I'm going with. Does that make sense? So many people are concerned if they're going to be going somewhere they don't want to go, they're concerned. If they're going somewhere they want to go, then their focus is not so much on him being with him there, but where he's taking them. Does that make sense? I mean, we're all happy to follow Jesus as long as he leads us somewhere and makes us happy. But it's not the following of Jesus. It's not, you know... You ever see a movie that was like a real love story? Anybody ever see one of those? I'll tell you what it's like. It's like some girl falls in love with a guy, he falls in love with her, and she goes, I will go anywhere with you. I mean, you know, there's stories of women, you know, they were princes or they were going to have this or that or whatever, and then they go, I will leave everything I got just to be with you. And everybody's saying, are you stupid? The guy doesn't have, you know, any, you know, visible means of support, and he's a bum or whatever, you know, because he's not, you know, a prince or all this kind of stuff. And she just sparkles in her eyes and she says, but I love him, you know. Well, you know what? People go to those movies. You know why? Because we think that there's something worth that. We think there's something to that. And you know what? They just make the same movie over and over and over. I mean, there's only so many love stories you can have. I mean, think about it. I mean, if you really thought about it, there's only, you know, you just have to keep changing the props up because the basic thing is the same. You know? I mean, the plot is, you know, two fall in love, then something happens, and then they think it's over with, and they leave, and they're all sad, and then they find out that it was not the way they thought, and they come back together and rush into each other's arms, and the music goes, and everybody goes, and they walk out. You just gotta change the props up. But I mean, how many movies can be made the same way, and yet people continue to go and go and go and go and go, and they will. Because there's something to that kind of love that says, I just want to be with you. I don't care where we go. If I'm with you, I'm okay. You ever heard that before? Yea, though I walk. Yea, though I walk. Walk. Through the valley of the shadow of death. It's a walk. If I do it, yea, if I do, My focus is not on the valley, but you. Another one of those poems. If I do, my focus is not on the valley, but you. I'll take it. So you see, this thing, I mean, why would the word walk all of a sudden be there in the 23rd Psalm in the valley of the shadow of death? Why would it be there? Why? I'll tell you exactly why. Because to defeat death, to defeat the shadow of death, to defeat the valley of the shadow of death is going to require a focus on him and not the place. It's the only way to defeat it. It's the only way to defeat it. And so my point of reading Ezekiel 33 is if you're in love with love, love that is not the Lord's love says everything has to be the way I want it, and that's what makes it so lovely. Can I get an amen? If everything's the way I want it, I'm in love. But you know, if you forget our anniversary or something like that, you're in trouble. I mean, you know, we're all caught up in days and times, and I mean, I've forgotten stuff. I've had to be in, I remember I was in Cuba once, and I know Carolyn's done the same thing, and Jim, and I was in Cuba once on my wife's anniversary. I said, well, I'm going to be leaving. It's going to be your anniversary this coming weekend. I won't be here. She goes, we'll be together. And if we get a chance to celebrate it later, I've seen Carolyn do that more than once. And you just question her about it, and she goes, well, praise God, We're putting the Lord first. It's not about our, some earth time when we got together. It's putting the Lord first that counts. And I just went, inside of my heart, I just went, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. That's not an excuse, men, for being insensitive. That was not the purpose of that, nor for you to get a copy of this tape and make your husband sit down and listen to it. The purpose is that we recognize the walk, that it be a walk, it not be an event. Everything's an event. It's an event. I go from one event to the next, this event and that event, and my life is made up of, 10, 12 events. The first major event of the year, you could say New Year's Eve. I've got to have a kiss at the New Year's Eve party. Then Valentine's Day, the day Randy was born. That you give Valentines to one another. And then, our anniversary in there somewhere, and then, Easter or, Father's Day or Mother's Day. I mean, you've heard it. People have gotten upset with me, I got my wife a corsage for Mother's Day. What'd you get her? I said, she's not my mother. I get my mother something. No, I get her stuff. I'm joking, but I'm trying to make a point. Then her birthday, and so then by the time you get to Christmas, you've got 12 events, and your life and marriage hang on fulfilling properly. It's like you're the high priest and she's God, and you do one thing out of line, baby, you die. Behind the veil. You miss one event. Ah, you missed it. I'm just telling you right now, and I'm not trying to side with men against women here. I'm trying to tell you that men have their event stuff too. They do. And they live from one event to another. It can't be events. It has to be oneness. Amen? Oneness. Oneness gets you through everything. Do you believe it? I believe it. I know it's true. Man, you got to get out of the earth and get into the real. Get into the raised. Get into the glory and out of the gory. You know, because it can get ugly. It really can get ugly. All right, how much time do I have left? Wow, let's go then. I think I'm going to finish on that one. Let's look at the next one. Still in Leviticus 21, it says blindness, lameness, or a lame, or he that hath a flat nose. Well, that's kind of a funny one, isn't it? You know, I know when my wife, she's got kind of a pointy nose, so when she read this, she said, well, thank you, Jesus. Not really, she didn't. But, you know, of course, again, we're not talking about physical stuff in that sense. And I know that some of you have been looking at this list and waiting for me to get to certain blemishes. I want to see how Randy handles this. I want to see him bring Jesus out of this. And I know that this flat nose is probably the one you were thinking of. Well, maybe not. A flat nose. Well, what does a flat nose do? It restricts the fragrance of Christ. And of course, you know where that's at, but let's turn there. 2 Corinthians. We need to look at the scriptures and not just talk about them. Amen? 2 Corinthians chapter 2. And verse 14. Now thanks be unto God, who always causes us to triumph in union with Christ, and maketh manifest the savor of his knowledge by us in every place. For we are unto God a sweet savor of Christ in them that are saved and in them that perish. To the one we are the savor of death unto death, and to the other the savor of life. Just think of that little phrase right there, the savor of life. How many of you not just talk about the life, but you have the savor of it, the sweet fragrance of it, the sweet fragrance, the savor of life? And who is sufficient for these things? It finishes off. Well, only those that are in union with Christ. That's why we triumph in union with Christ. That's why it's sweet. That's why it's a sweet savor. That's the sweetness of it. And so a flat nose, it restricts the full taking in of the savor that is Christ. No, not ears. It didn't say anything wrong with ears. It's talking about the nose. Isn't that interesting? You know that it is, I'm just going to say this. Do you know it's possible to be deceived by someone who does not come bearing the fragrance of Christ? Because as priests, we have a flat nose, so we wouldn't know it anyway. We're not even, as a priest with a flat nose, we're not even attuned to that area, of the area of fragrance of Christ. You know, no, of course, we're not talking about physical, actual fragrance. We're talking about the spiritual sensation of the fragrance that is Christ. Something different, very different than hearing. Can I get an amen? Very different from seeing. this is directly related to your nose. This is directly related to being able to pick up, as a priest, to pick up on the fragrance that is around you. Do you see it? Do you see how important that would be? And that especially important if we can be deceived by somebody who comes and, you know, we're around somebody and they speak of Christ. But we're not only supposed to listen to the words, we are supposed to test for the fragrance of Christ. Think about it. Only priests will do that. Only priests are aware that the lack of that disqualifies them. And is considered of God, that's a blemish that you have. If you're a priest, and you are, if you're a priest and you're restricting that area, not giving credence to it, then I guarantee you are open to deception, because it is possible for someone to come and say all of the right words and not have anything of the fragrance that is Christ. And here's what we do. Here's what we tend to do. We do, you know, particularly in the American society. If anybody is given honor on any level, we just think they're the best person. We treat them like they've, you know, got character or something. You know, for example, an athlete. If an athlete is really good, I mean really, really good, whether it's basketball, there's a name comes to my mind right now, baseball, you know. There was a basketball player that got in trouble for some really bad stuff, but you know what? He paid his way out of it. He paid the person off. And then he came back strong and basically carried the team on his shoulders and got him into the playoff, primarily because of one player who is good at basketball and bad at character. You couldn't smell the fragrance of Christ anywhere. Movie stars, oh, I love Tom Cruise. Well, you better be careful. You'd be surprised who loves Tom Cruise. That's another story, but never mind. Apparently, we don't know about that. But, because he's a good actor or he looks cute or whatever, in a girl's mind, he fulfills my dream. Some other girl, some actress. I mean, I saw two actresses, both of them, two different girls on a talk show, and one of them very famous, very well known, and in a lot of movies, and she was just the most ditzy chick I ever heard in my life. I mean, I could not believe it. It was just, it was extreme. I mean, it was like, I thought, my God, just act the rest of your life. Don't. Please don't show us what you're really like. It was just extreme, though. It was way out there. And I was just going, And, now she's what, in her 30s or something, and she's not married yet, and the boyfriend she had lasted, a short time, and he finally got tired of it because, it just was like, and you're just going, do you have a mind? No, but I have acting ability. Well, that's good enough. We'll all adore you, even though you're a dork. Or worse. Come on, folks. I mean, honestly, with me, I can stand up here, I can say good stuff, and you can go, he's a great man of God. You've got to make sure your nostrils are clear. You've got to make sure you can pick up the fragrance of Christ, not just the right teaching. Come on. I'm serious. You can't just go by what you see or what you hear in the natural. You've got to know from the Lord. Every one of you ought to check that up. Not just about me, but Jim and Scott and others. Man, am I getting the fragrance of Christ? You know, I love Jim's teaching and whatever because I always get the fragrance of Christ. I mean, that's, you know, somebody could say, well, Jim's not as good a teacher as you are. Well, maybe there's a lot more fragrance of Christ. You know, for the priest, it didn't say you got to have great ears. Because you got to be able to pick up the fragrance of Christ. You cannot have a restricted flow where you're not even thinking in that avenue. You're too busy swooning over the message again, or swooning over the messenger, which is really dumb if you just, let's just consider that for a minute. I mean, come on, let's just do that. Since I got this shirt on, let's say a UPS guy comes to your door. You're a 21-year-old girl who's engaged to a guy that's in Iraq. He's been over there for a year. You both found out 2 months ago that instead of coming home, his tour of duty has been extended for another 6 months. But he's sent the most glorious love letter to you, UPS, but this guy's got to read it to you. And I mean, you know, he's got the nice UPS thing, but you know, he's got he's sort of a dork, and you know, it's like,
hello, ma'am. I got a special letter here for you, and I'm gonna read it, cause that's what they pay me for. Oh, sweetie. You are my dream. I love you more than life itself.
And you're just sitting there listening to the message. You're going, oh, come here. He's just a messenger. He had nothing to do with it. You know, it's not his letter to you. It's the Lord's love letter, the Word of God to you. It's the Lord loving on you. It's the Lord knowing where you're at, exactly where you're at. It's the Lord. It's that precious, precious good shepherd. It's that precious husband. It's that he cares. He knows right where you're at. It's not the stinking messenger. That would be so dumb. Then, you know, your husband comes back from Iraq and you're shacked up with, you know, UPS boy. You know. Well, you know, don't be shacking up with the preacher in that sense, too. You know, don't be thinking that he's something he's not. See the Lord. Get the Lord. But I'm telling you, test for the fragrance of Christ. Seriously, test for the fragrance of Christ. Don't, people will wow you with teachings. Do not be wowed with teachings. Be wowed with the Lord himself and the fragrance of Christ. Be wowed. And know in the mouth of two or three witnesses, if you understand what I mean, you hear the message, you know it bears witness with your spirit, and you have another witness, you don't have a flat nose, you are taking in as much of the fragrance of Christ as you can. Well, what is the example? What is the example we have? We have the example of Mary of Bethany. Coming in, taking the alabaster box. Folks, it says that alabaster box full of precious ointment, that it was very expensive, very costly. Okay. I want you to think about this. She broke that for Jesus and his burial, right? It says that. Well, think about this. It wasn't that much earlier, just a few days. that her own brother died and she didn't break it for his burial. Her own brother died and she didn't break it for his burial. But she saw something in Jesus worth everything. Jesus is the only one that's worth it all. He is. He is. Thank God that he does dwell in vessels, amen? Thank God that he actually lives in vessels. But there's more vessels that talk about him than let him live. The last one was lameness. This is, you know, we could have really got off on lameness because there's a lot of lame, well, never mind. But this is talking about not just walking, but discerning brokenness that releases Christ. I mean, really? My God, I don't even know how to say this because I don't know that I'm getting it across. I'm just telling you that there are a lot of messenger boys, but there's not a lot of broken vessels. There are a lot of good messenger boys. How do you know someone's broken? Because they act humble when they preach? No. You know they're broken when you smell, when you take in the fragrance of Christ. Can you kind of see that? They may say things that sound proud. They're probably not being prideful, but it can sound that way. You know that. You can say things and someone will take it and go, oh, he thinks he's everything. You know, and the person may actually be saying the opposite of that. So you're not going to, if you pick up only on demeanor, but there is a fragrance of Christ. It transcends hearing. It filled that room. Filled that room. And it was at that point, if you check it out, that it looked like Judas decided this was it. I mean, just read the scriptures and look at it. It's like when that fragrance filled the room and Jesus was being honored in that way, then that's it. Just look real close at it. I think I noticed that this marked something very drastic in Judas. Well, you know, maybe you can compete on the preaching level. Maybe you can exceed others on the preaching level, but you get upset when they're done. People are affected by the living presence, the fragrance of Christ. I know people like that. We have people in this body that are that way. But we also have people that it's like they're broken for a while and then they go back to being a strong vessel. And then they get broken, then it's back, you know. It's like they haven't fallen on the rock, much less let the rock fall on them, you know. Grind you to powder where there's no coming back. The good thing about ashes, you've been reduced to the lowest human form and you don't even look like your original form. It's just Christ. Well, that's, you know, fragrance is a wonderful thing. And the wonder, and let me try to end with this. Fragrance is incredible because you talk about it in the Song of Solomon where my beauty, my whatever is like a garden enclosed, like a, yeah. And a garden enclosed, you can put a wall around a garden and imagine all the fragrances coming out. And it says, blow, O north wind, blow, and take that fragrance over the wall. The neat thing about fragrance is it can transcend boundaries and blockages. It can't be held in by walls. You can put, you know, you can build a high wall. Nobody can get out. And that'll happen to you probably eventually. Something will happen where you can't preach and you can't minister. Well, the Lord allowed that because he wants to see if you'll fall back on something very precious to him, to let the fragrance of Christ begin to rise. Isn't it wonderful? It rises. That's the way the concept is. It rises and it goes over and it reaches where nothing else would reach. Praise God. All right, well, there was the bad one that you're looking for, a flat nose. Everything else is downhill from here, easy to explain. All right, I guess let's stand together and we'll close out. Man, I want the Lord, don't you? I mean, I really want the real Lord. Dang, I just don't want this old religious way. I just don't. I mean, the best thing to do is just quit wanting people to be impressed with you and just let the fragrance of Christ impress them. And they'll say, I sense the sweet fragrance of Christ on you. And you just say to them, well, that's Jesus. I stink. If it's Jesus' resurrection, a sweet fragrance comes forth. If it's Lazarus's, he stinketh. You make the choice. Let it be Christ in death, burial, and resurrection. Father, we look to you. We long after your Son, the one to whom we are joined. May the realities of that work in us. And Father, as priests, Father, my greatest desire is that these classes on what it means to be a New Testament priest will not just fall on deaf ears, but Father, we will gather in all that we can, all that we're able, and meditate on it day and night and seek to have these things worked into us. Help us not to develop patterns of just hearing and then going away and saying, I heard a lovely song. Father, help us to not train ourselves wrong, but to be active, not passive. To walk and follow you, not just hear about you and sit down and muse about it. Father, we cannot do this. Who is sufficient in these things? Well, none of us, but we are sufficient in union with you. So we believe it in a real way. And as branches, we just suck in your life into us. We don't just sit there and say, well, it's true, so it must be true. We actively pursue being filled with your life. We put it all in your hands. We love you.